Hi, I'm Dr. Sunil Kini, and I would like to talk on complications of hip and knee arthroplasty. We all know that with the success of modern-day joint replacement, it's largely attributed to evolution of tribology and design mechanics. It's also imperative to recognize that there's no surgery without complications. So we as joint replacement surgeons try to avoid or minimize complications. And when they do occur, we need to recognize and have the armamentarium to treat them effectively to ensure the best outcome. So we'll start with the hip arthroplasty complications first. So they can be classified as either duration-based or etiology-based. When you say duration-based, it could be either early, which is defined as one that occurs within 6 weeks or 3 months after surgery, and one which occurs thereafter is called as late. Similarly, etiology-based classification can be either patient-based, surgeon-based, or implant-based. So when you see the enlisted complications, the first few, that's bleeding, wound complications, deep vein thrombus, permanent embolism, neurovascular injury, and dislocations, are usually recognized as early causes. The ones below, the periprosthetic fractures, abductor muscle dysfunction, heterotopic ossification, osteolysis, loosening, they all come under late. However, there could be some overlap. So if you call periprosthetic fractures, can occur either intra-op, then they become early, or they can occur anytime thereafter, such as after a fall, then they become late causes. Similarly, dislocation could be early in most of the cases, but also many a times, which we will discuss later, they could be a result of either wear or impingement, and they can occur many years after the index surgery, and then it becomes late causes. So coming to hematoma formation, so they are attributed mainly to incomplete control of bleeding during surgery. So either you fail to ligate the bleeders well, as a result of which they form a hematoma, which manifests themselves later. So what are the causes? Some of the enlisted causes are bleeding from the obturator vessels. So this is mainly encountered close to the transverse acetabular ligament, especially when you try to release inferiorly just to get your inferior homens in during surgery. You can see some torrential bleeding from underneath the transverse acetabular ligament. So these are mainly from the obturator vessels. So one must be careful when you place the inferior homen during or before acetabular rimming. Second is profunda femoris, so which we know is a branch of the femoral artery, which again has a medial and lateral branches. The medial branch is mainly encountered during the posterior approach to the hip, especially under the quadratus femoris. So that's the reason we don't cut the lower part of the quadratus femoris, or if we encounter bleeding, we'll have to ligate that part because it occurs usually from the medial circumflex femoral branch. Similarly, the lateral circumflex femoral branch is also liable to bleed, and this is mainly during the direct anterior approach to the hip. And this vessel is mainly seen in the interval between the sartorius and the tensor fasciae lata. So medial branch during the posterior approach and lateral during the direct anterior approach. So this must be remembered. Similarly, you can also get bleeding from the branch of the femoral vessels, especially under the anterior capsule. And so you must be very careful with your anterior acetabular retract. Right. So next, coming to bleeding from the vessels, superior inferior gluteal vessels, and these vessels are usually located and identified especially during the lateral approach of the Harding approach to the hip. So you note that these approaches are usually within 5 centimeters from the tip of the greater trochanter. So they can also cause significant bleeding. Next, coming to the iliac vessels, when are they encountered? These are mainly encountered during reaming of the acetabulum. So when you over enthusiastically ream through the acetabulum, in case you ream through the medial wall, there you must note that the iliac vessels can be encountered. So never get close or ream through the medial wall of the acetabulum. And many reasons you can also get bleeding after many days after surgery, which could be due to a false aneurysm from iliopsoas impingement. So these are the cases where you can get a hematoma formation. So luckily most of them can be managed conservatively, but there are some indications for surgical treatment, especially the following three. One is wound dehiscence or marginal necrosis. Hematoma can cause significant neural compression, and they can be associated with a nerve palsy, either the femoral nerve palsy in the front or the sciatic nerve palsy behind during the posterior approach. So that is also must be recognized and must be intervened to decompress the nerve. The third is an infected hematoma. So supposedly you notice that a few days after surgery you get a serious ooze. You must always be wary, and this can soon change into seropurulent or purulent discharge. So you must always identify an infected hematoma. So what do you do next? So in case we go in, so the golden rule is you need to debride any necrotic tissue, because that can be a source of infection, and infection is one thing that we as joint replacement surgeons dread. Hemostasis, make sure you catch the bleeder, identify it, catch it, and cauterize or hemostasis. And the closure must always be watertight. Many a time we see that if you don't have a water sealed closure, then that cavity can be a source of infection. And it's always better to close over drains, especially in this scenario. Another important classification is heterotopic ossification. So there's some high risk groups in which we must be vigilant. One is patient with hypertrophic post-traumatic arthritis, especially in males. Some conditions such as ankylosing spondylitis, which comes under seronegative arthritis, DISH, diffuse interstitial skeletal hyperostosis, Paget's disease, these conditions are liable for forming heterotopic bone. Thirdly, some approaches, especially the anterior and anterolateral approaches, you must remember that are more liable to cause heterotopic ossification. So there's a classification for this. If you look at the X-ray on the right side, you can see that there is bone formation there, and this is what we refer to as heterotopic bone. So there are many classification. Main classification for that is the Brooker classification, and you can see there are four varieties. The first variety is where you see islands of bone, right, here and there. So this is mainly seen in the junction between the abductors and the ilium. So these are specks of bone, what we call, and this is classically type 1. Type 2, again you see bones which originates from both ends, from the tip of the GT as well as from the ilium, but you see a clear 1 centimeter gap between them. So that's type 2. So in type 3, the gap reduces to less than 1 cm. So in type 2, it's more than 1 cm. In type 3, the gap between the bony ends is less than 1 cm. And type 4 is what we call as a fusion, and they're absolutely fused. So when you talk of clinical symptoms, they all manifest as pain. Sometimes they may not be even pain, but there's definite restriction of movements, and in late stages they can even be ankle loss. That's when it becomes quite critical to treat them. So do you need routine prophylaxis for all patients? No. So only those with high risk category, as I described before, conditions such as Angstbone, Paget's, DISH, or patients with anterior anterolateral approaches, in these cases you must definitely consider prophylaxis treatment. So prophylaxis can either be radiation, thankfully it is low dose radiation, which doesn't affect much to the stability of the implant. and also medications, mainly the COX-2 is what we use, and it's recommended that we use it for a minimum duration of about 6 weeks. In case we are giving radiation, the radiation doses as low as 500 centigrade is effective for the cause. Coming next to neurological injuries. Thankfully, neurological injuries are not very common. And the risk of nerve palsy, as in many articles, in the primary replacement is about 0.5%. But increases in certain conditions, especially the dysplastic hip, to about 2.3%. In revision scenarios, it increases up to about 3.5%. So it also recognizes that the neurological injuries risk is more in women compared to men. There are certain risk factors we must recognize. The first and foremost is the dysplastic hip. That may be due to many facts. It's definitely increased when you lengthen it beyond a certain point, books say about 4 centimeters or more. But also in conditions where you don't lengthen it much, say even up to, say even if you lengthen by 1.5 centimeters, which otherwise in a normal hip you would not have found any neurological injury, you may find that in hip dysplasia, even if you don't lengthen much, the risk of nerve palsy, especially the sciatic nerve in the posterior approach, is about 2 times higher. It may be due to the sensitivity of the nerve and also to the point that the stretchability of the nerve is not much in dysplastic hips. Other conditions where you note are in the post-traumatic arthritis. The posterior approach, the injury to the sciatic nerve is more. Certain approaches, certain nerve injuries are more prone. Cementless fixation. It's also important to note that the injury during cementless fixation is mainly during when you insert the screws. That is why we must make sure that the screws are not too long. Especially in the posterior approach, there is a risk of a sciatic nerve being compressed when you put a screw which is too long into the posterior column, posterior wall. Revision surgeries are more prone for neurological injuries, probably because of the fact that there's a lot of scarring and you would not recognize the planes as well as you do in a primary hip. Female sex is found that neurological injuries are more common. And as I discussed before, if you have significant lengthening of the extremity, the cutoff may be about 3.5 to 4 centimeters, we find that nerve injuries are more liable, especially the sciatic nerve in a posterior approach. So this is one article from Smalls Wright in 97 Core Journal, which was published, where he noted that incidence of sciatic nerve was about 79%, highest in his series. Femoral was about 13% and obturator about 1.6%. So what is the etiology for nerve injuries? One is direct surgical trauma. This may occur especially during the retractor placement, as we note. So in the anterior part, especially either during the anterior, direct anterior approach, or even during the posterior approach, if you're overzealous in your anterior acetabular retraction, you may get a femoral nerve component palsy. So it's important that when, as a practical tip, when you put your femoral retractors, you put it slightly on the higher side anteriorly rather than the lower side. So similarly, in a posterior approach, if you try to put your homens more in the posterior aspect, especially the 9 o'clock or 3 o'clock when you're doing the left hip, you can also injure the sciatic nerve or branches of that. So extremity position, you must be careful. Limb lengthening, as I discussed before. Ischemia, and sometimes thermal injury from cement can also cause neural compression and injury. So we must be wary of the nerve in certain conditions, especially when the anatomy of hip is distorted. In protrusio acetabuli, in shortening of the femoral head and neck, in revision surgeries, because I said in revision surgeries the planes are often not well demarcated and you may inadvertently injure the nerve, and congenital dysplasia as we discussed before. So how do you manage? X-rays are definitely helpful because X-rays can show you a lot of information which is valuable especially in regards to a screw placement. If the screws are long, then you can definitely recognize them on an X-ray more often than not. EMG and NCV are usually reserved for duration only after about 6 weeks if the nerve recovery does not occur. Ultrasound of the sciatic nerve is also, or a magnetic resonance nerve imaging is also an option with the gradient suppression images to look for the cores or the anatomy of the sciatic nerve or any nerve for that matter. So CT MRI is invaluable. CT, especially in with the three-dimensional views, you can always see for the protrusion of the screws, because as I said earlier, screws can be a source of nerve compression. Similarly, on an MRI, you can see for any hematoma, as I discussed, which can cause compression on the nerve. Pseudoaneurysms can also be detected well on MR imaging. So clinically, we know that advancing tinel sign is beneficial, a motor march sign is beneficial, and they suggest that the nerve may recover depending on what the type of injury that is classified. So in all these cases, if we have to do something, it's proven that neurolysis of the nerve is beneficial towards recovery. So late exploration of the nerve, especially sciatic nerve, is beneficial if it's not present in 6 weeks. And I said before, it's either a mass of cement or a transestablished screw can often be made out on a CT scan, or sometimes on an X-ray, which can actually compress the nerve. So superior gluteal nerve is also a source of compression, especially when you're going to the direct lateral approach or the Harding's approach. So you have to be very careful that an important practical tip is to never extend your incision or exploration beyond the tip of the greater trochanter. So here you can see the tip there, and this distance is usually about 5 centimeters. So you note that, so the safe zone is about 5 centimeters. So you must always recognize that this safe zone is broad anteriorly, right? And as we come more, is broad posteriorly, and as we come more anteriorly, the zone becomes more narrow. So it may be 5 centimeters at its broadest part, which is more posteriorly. And as it comes narrow, it becomes narrow as it comes more anteriorly. So coming next to vascular injuries. So vascular injuries are rare, seen about 0.04% of primary and 0.2% of revision surgeries. Mortality rates is less than 10%, and there is a risk of permanent disability if not treated well. So very good practical guide is a classification by Vasilevsky, which mainly describes and classifies acetabulum into quadrant system. As you know, the vascular injuries are most common, especially when you put screws in an uncemented cup scenario. So let's see later what this classification is. So what are the risk factors for vascular injury? Number one, prior vascular surgery is a risk factor. Prior pelvic orthopedic surgeries, because the plane delineation is not very good in these cases. Dysplastic hips are more common for vascular injury. Protrusio acetabuli, especially when with a soft wall, you can easily go through the medial wall, and right next to that is the external iliacs. So you must be very careful when you're reaping the medial wall, especially in protrusio. So you never go medial. So you never go to the floor in protrusio. You always aim for the rim or the periphery. We need a peripheral fit, and then you actually graft and you build it up. So you never reap the medial wall. So Paget's disease in a similar cause. And an infected hip, because in an infected hip, we always realize, or you must have seen practically, that the vascularity is very high. So vascular injuries are more common. So especially when you're planning for revision, you must be very careful. So in these cases, this is one of my cases wherein we actually see here that the primary was a cemented processes which was done. And that has actually gone in. It's migrated centrally, medially. And you can see that the whole cup, cemented cup, is gone inside the acetabulum with the cement. And the trochanter is almost touching the ilium. So when you do or you try to attempt these kind of surgeries, you must be careful. You always get a CT angiogram because you need to know how far your cup is to the vessels, in relation to the vessels. In this case, it was very close, probably less than half a centimeter difference when we did a CT angiogram in this case. So why is this important? Because if there's so much of scarring, you may not be able to remove the implant. It's very dangerous to remove the implant from the femoral side. So you may have to go through what we call as a retroperitoneal approach or transperitoneal approach and take out the cup from there without damaging the vessels. And then you can carry on your revision hip replacement as you have planned before. So it's very important that in protrusio and revisions, you have got a useful tool in form of a CT angiogram, which you use to see where exactly, how far you are from the vascular field. So surgical technique is also very important because vascular injuries occur during these steps of surgery. Number one, when you manipulate the hip, especially when you dislocate and relocate, that's why it's very important that you as a main surgeon are in full control and not your assistant when you're especially dislocating and relocating the hip. So the rotations must be determined by you and not by your team member. Similarly, when hammering, when you try to hammer too much, especially when you're putting the cup or when you're putting the stem trials or the actual thing, you must be careful not to hammer it too much. Cement extrusion can also, into the pelvis, can also cause thermal injuries to the vessels. In revision scenarios, if you have a periprosthetic or if you're wiring cabling around the femur, you must be very careful that you don't injure any of the vessels, especially the perforators or the vessels around the upper half of the femur. As discussed before, screw placement in acetabulum is very important, and here we come to the classification which we call as the Vasilevsky classification. So what he's majorly advocated is dividing the acetabulum into quadrants, right? So he has divided this through a line which goes to the anterosuperior iliac spine and bisects the center of the acetabulum, and then here the perpendicular is drawn in the direction opposite to it. So here you can note that there are quadrants which are divided as follows. So we have the posterior superior quadrant, we have the posterior inferior quadrant, we have the antero superior quadrant, and we have the antero inferior quadrant. So during posterior superior and posterior inferior are the safest quadrants, especially the posterior superior quadrant, because two reasons. Because here you can get the maximum purchase with your screw. Luckily, whenever you put a cup, when you put a cup with screws, we make sure that the holes, if you're using a three-hole cup, which I usually do, these three holes must be located along the posterior superior quadrant mainly, or the posterior inferior slightly. So this is important because these are the only safe zones. The moment you go anterior superior, there's a danger to the external iliac vessels. And the moment you put your screw in the anterior inferior, there is a danger to obturator vessels. So you must remember very well that the safe zone is the posterior superior and the posterior inferior quadrant. In posterior inferior, you must be also careful that your screw length must not exceed ideally about 15 to 20 mm because there's the sciatic and the gluteal nerves which can be injured. So luckily we can always palpate when you're doing the posterior approach, you can always palpate posteriorly and make sure that the depth gauge is not too far, and you can measure accurately and make sure that the screws are not too long. In this case, so how do you manage vascular injury? So local compression, identify the bleeders, ligate it, put clips, put stitches, whatever, but you have to identify and ligate it on table. So if it is hemodynamic instability, then you call for help, call for a lap or a vascular surgeon. In certain cases, it may need angiography with selective embolization. In very few cases, it may require what we call as thrombectomy, stenting, or end-to-end anastomosis.